استمع لذلك.
الحمد لله نحمده سبحانه وتعالى ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له قيوم السماوات والأرضين، وأشهد أن محمداً عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله الأطهار وصحابته الأخيار ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الجزاء. أما بعد، يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. ثم أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها فإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة وصاحبها في النار والعياذ بالله تعالى من النار. فالسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We thank Allah سبحانه وتعالى. The most merciful, may his peace and blessings be upon the noble Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household followers, and all those who tread the path of Allah until the day of judgment. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to preserve all of us. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to rectify our affairs, worldly and that of afterlife. Barakallahu feekum. This gathering is very important because it is to teach us our deen. It is to help us be firm upon the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wa ala fahmi salaf al ummah, based upon the path of the righteous predecessors of Islam, the likes of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala an, the likes of Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, the likes of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an, the likes of Ali, the son of Abi Talib رضي الله تعالى عنه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. So this is going to be our path, and that is our manhaj. If you see someone loving these companions that I've just mentioned, and he acts upon their way as they acted upon the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, based upon that which comes from the kitab and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, know that this person loves the sunnah. Know that this person is upon khair. May Allah make us among them. Na'am, the path to seeking knowledge is the path that takes a person to Jannah. The Prophet clearly indicated that من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سهل الله له طريقا به إلى الجنة. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام, whoever takes the path of knowledge, he seeks for knowledge to act upon it and to teach others. خيركم من تعلم القرآن وعلم. The best among you is the one who learns the Quran and teaches others. So you seek the path of haqq, the path of studying the book of Allah, understanding it, acting upon it for your akhirah. Na'am. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, according to the Prophet, is going to make for you a path to Jannah. Allah is going to make easy for you the path leading to Jannah. May Allah make us among them. Allahumma ja'alna minhum. Na'am. So brothers, before you act upon something, al-ilmu qabla al-qawli wal-amal. As Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullahu ta'ala, mentions in one of the opening chapters of his book. This is the bab, al-ilmu qabla al-qawli wal-amal. Knowledge precedes statement and action. Without no knowledge, you're going to mess up. You're going to destroy yourself. You're going to act upon something that is not accepted by Allah. And you're going to be doing this for years. And one day, if you are told that this is not right, it's not easy to quit. Because you'll be thinking, for years I've been doing these things. All of a sudden, somebody got to tell me it's not right. Then the shaytan plays with you and you're going to be upon that path of misguidance. Illa man rahim Allah. When a person that wants good, when he's reminded, he tells the person that reminds him, Ya akhi jazakallahu khair. Thank you, I didn't know these things. Then he's going to act upon khair. Na'am. Inna al-umura bil khawatim. It is not how you started, but how you ended. You may start something good, and you hoping that Allah place you upon khair until you depart from this temporal life. And this good. You may start something good and live it one day, and you die upon the path of evil. May Allah save us. So a person may start something that is not right, and one day, if Allah wants good for him, one of the brothers is gonna remind him, Ya Akhi, I love you for Allah. But this thing right here is against the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because Allah says in the Quran, وَإِن تُطِيعُوهُ تَهْتَدُوا. If you follow the Prophet, you'll be guided. But this thing that you're doing, my brother, I know you love khair, but this is not right. And he says, Ya Akhi, thank you for correcting me. Teach me. Then you teach him the knowledge that you are sure of from Kitab wa Sunnah. Na'am. And this person has no arrogance. It shows that this person has khair in him. And inshallah, barakallahu feekum. Excuse me to give you one example. When I finish the prayers, alhamdulillah, the brother sitting next to me, perhaps he wants khair, but he did something that pains me. Then I say, this is my brother, man. Let me finish praying my sunnah. Then I can correct it, perhaps. But unfortunately, I forgot who the brother is. I could not see him after that. Then I say, well, it is obligatory upon me to correct it, to mention it in the masjid. And also the Imam, barakallahu fi, time to time he corrects us. He tells us what is the sunnah. Barakallahu fi. Na'am. So I saw the brother, he did something like this. When he's about to say salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah to the right, coming back to the right, to the left, then he did this. So this question, this, where did he get it from? That is in the sunnah. It is not from the sunnah. So it is wajib upon the imam when he sees mistakes among the people to correct it generally and to correct it individually.
He may call the brother to the office. Ya akhi, can I talk to you? Because it's wajib on him. And this the brother will be upon khayr. So when he finishes that, he also did this. When he did this, then he started doing this. Then he wiped over his faces. And I say, Allahu Akbar. This is not from the sunnah. The Prophet, when he finishes praying, he says, Astaghfirullah. Thalatha marratin. Three times, mustaqbil al-qibla. Facing the qibla, he will say, Astaghfirullah. Oh Allah, forgive me. Three times. And some brothers, sometimes they don't even say, An-nutq as-sahih, you don't say that. He's going to be saying, Astaghfirullah, with the kaf. Instead of Astaghfirullah, with the ghain. Because when you say, Astaghfirullah, oh Allah, forgive me. I ask of the forgiveness of Allah. But when you say, Astaghfirullah, I ask of the disbelief of Allah. A'udhu billah. You see, that's why some of the scholars, they mention that there's also what we call kufr lafz. A person does not mean it, but he says something that may be associated with kufr. Meaning he's going to mention something of shirk that he is not aware. Or he's going to say something to insult Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he is not aware. So if you learn the sunnah, you know that did you teach him? Perhaps he does not know. Perhaps his intention is good. وَالْأَمْرُ كَمَا قَالَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَىٰ عَنْ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنُ مَسْعُودِ كَمْ مِنْ مُرِيدِي الْخَيْرِ لَمْ يُدْرِكُهُ. Some people, they want good, but they are not able to get to the good. Why? Because of jahl. That's why they say, كُنْ عَالِمًا أَوْ مُتَعَلِّمًا أَوْ مُسْتَمِعًا. Either you teaching somebody or you coming to the masjid benefiting. Well, Imam Jazahullah Khair, he says, if you know a brother, you could text him to tell them there's khair in the masjid to come benefit. It is part of at-ta'awun, al-birr wa taqwa. As Allah says in the Quran, wa ta'awanu ala al-birr wa taqwa, wa la ta'awanu ala al-ithm wa al-udwan. Help one another upon righteousness and the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not help one another upon transgression and sinning against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you saw your brother upon this misguidance, you teach him. Then when he takes it, you say, brother, ana uhibbuka fillah. I love you, man. Because why? You acting upon the sunnah. This is tariqun najah. That we're going to save ourselves from the punishment of hellfire. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. If you want victory, success in this life, follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As Allah mentions in the Quran, Surah Al-Ahzab, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. Subhanallah. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Whoever obeys the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has indeed and automatically obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهِ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. If you love Allah truly, follow the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Because that shows you love Allah. But you say you love Allah, you forgot about the fact that it is not because you say you love Allah, meaning Allah loves you. Sometimes you may see a woman, young girl, you want to marry, right? You say, I love this girl. You're going to go talk to her family members, or her father, or her mother, to help you. But all of a sudden, this young girl says, I don't love him. I don't like him. You see, you may love something, but does not mean the thing loves you. Subhanallah. Walillahi mathal al-a'la. How much more of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You claim you love Allah, but does Allah love you? But at least you can act upon good with ikhlas, with fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hoping that Allah loves you for it, and making dua that you finish this dunya upon khayr. Allahumma ja'al akhira kalamina min ad-dunya shahadata an la ilaha illallah, wa tawaffana wa anta radin anna ghayra ghadban. واجعلنا في موقف القيامة آمنين مع الذين لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. That's what we're saying. That's our dua. We're making this dua all the time because we never know when we're going to die. When you love your brother, love him for Allah. When you hate your brother, hate him for Allah. He's doing some shirk, you hate the shirk. Naam, he's upon sunnah. You love him, you try to help him. This is true love. But it is not love when someone is doing haram, committing shirk, going to fortune tellers, doing magics left and right, and the lie. You love them, you push them. A'udhu billah, what kind of love is this? So your brother is the one that tells you this is good, do. Your brother is the one that tells you this is evil, stay away from it. But the person that supports your evil and ma'asiyah, a'udhu billah, this brother does not love you, man. May Allah make it easy upon us. So brothers, be a person that seeks knowledge. Be a person that teaches others. If you understand the knowledge, you have the fiqh. Be a person that comes to masjid to benefit the people or benefit himself and others, and listen. But don't be a person who does not seek knowledge, does not teach nobody, does not listen to knowledge. What's she gonna be then? It's better for you to leave this dunya than being on top of the earth. It's better for you to be under the earth. Because you don't know why you were created. Because the major goal of life is what? To go to Jannah. For us to be saved from hellfire. And the purpose of life is to worship Allah upon Tawheed. If you know Tawheed, inshaAllah ta'ala, you're going to also know the opposite of Tawheed, which is shirk. وَبِذِذِّهَا تَتَمَيَّزُ الْأَشْيَاءُ. If you know Tawheed, you're going to know the shirk, to avoid the shirk. عَرَفْتُ الشَّرَّ لَا لِلشَّرِّ وَلَكِنْ لِتَوَقِّيهِ مَنْ لَمْ يَعْرِفَ الْخَيْرِ مَنْ لَمْ يَعْرِفَ الشَّرِّ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ يَطَعْ فِيهِ. نعم. So the Sha'ir, he says, I know the evil not to commit evil, but to stay away from it. If you don't know the evil from the right, you may fall into the evil. SubhanAllah. If you know Sunnah, you're going to know Tawheed. So you're going to know what? Bid'ah. So you stay away from the bid'ah. If you love Quran, you're going to stay away from music. As a Muslim, you listen to music in your home. A'udhu billah. How are you going to get tarbiyah hasana for your kids? A'udhu billah. Some brothers in their cars, especially our Muslim brothers, he's doing Uber. You go into his car. Bim, 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 bim. Limada ya Shaykh? Listen to Quran. Naam. If a Muslim enters into your car, you turn off everything. You put on the Quran. Naam. Perhaps they love it. Perhaps they even take Shahada. Perhaps they ask you, man, can you teach me what is he talking about? You explain the Sunnah. But listening to music, it brings shayateen. Unless in a situation whereby you went in a place, you never expected anything, then there's a music. You do what you have to do, you leave quick. Because it's not in your hands. But with your own hands, you what? You play music and you go to sleep. Some people will say, man, this music is a cool number. If I don't listen to it, I cannot sleep good. A'udhu billah, you want to sleep with shayateen. Recite Ayatul Kursi. Go in accordance to the formality of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Learn from the sunnah. Recite Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Qul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq. Qul a'udhu bi rabbin nas. Recite Ayatul Kursi. Recite the du'as, Allahumma qini azabak, yawma tab'afu ibadak. Bismika rabbi wa da'atu jambi, wa bika arfa'u, in amsakta nafsi, farhamha, wa in arsaltaha, fahfadha, bima tahfad bihi ibadika salihin. Allahumma aslamtu nafsi ilayk, wa fawattu amri ilayk, wa aljahtu zahri ilayk, raghbatan wa rahbatan ilayk, la malja' wa la manja' minka illa ilayk. All the way to the end, from the sunnah. And if you can make wudu before you go to sleep, and even pray two raka'atayn, at least go to sleep with wudu, Allah gonna preserve you. There's even a riwayah that says that Allah will make possible some angels, na'am, to be with you that night, for you to be protected. Bi'idnillah tabaraka wa ta'ala. You forget about all this sunnah, teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you claim you love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How are you going to show your love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That's not what you say in the YouTube. Somebody will say some things about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you go there and it's insulting, doing some things, but when it comes to acting upon the sunnah, you don't act upon the sunnah. Fasting on Yawm al-Ithnayn, wa Yawm al-Khamis, you good, you strong, but you will not fast. ثَمَانِيَةٌ تَجِرِي عَلَى النَّاسِ كُلِّهِمِ وَلَا بُدَّ لِلْمَرْءِ يَلْقَى ثَمَانِيَةٌ سُرُورٌ وَحُزْنٌ وَاجْتِمَاعٌ وَفُرْقَةٌ وَهَمٌ وَغَمٌ ثُمَّ سُقْمٌ وَعَافِيَةٌ. 8 things regardless, they're gonna happen to you in your life. Sometimes you sad, sometimes you happy, sometimes you sick and the like. Do you know when you sick, you may not be able to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Perhaps from this sickness, you're not gonna make it from that to death. But before the sickness, what did you do? Did you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And Allah gonna ask you on the Yawm al-Qiyamah. So everybody gonna do muhasamatul nafs. Na'am, self-accountability. What did I do right for me to continue to do good? Where did I do wrong for me to stay away from doing wrong? Because one day death may come. Na'am. وَلَوْ أَنَّا إِذَا مِتْنَا تُرِكْنَا لَكَانَ الْمَوْتُ رَاحَةَ كُلَّ حَيٍّ وَلَكِنَّا إِذَا مِتْنَا بُعِثْنَا وَنُسْأَلُ بَعْدَهُ أَمْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ تَذَكَّرْ فِي مَشِيدِكَ وَالْمَآدِ وَدَفْنِكَ بَعْدَ عِزِّكَ فِي التُرَابِ إِذَا أُدْخِلْتَ أَأَنْتَ فِيهِ تُقِيمُ بِهِ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْحِسَابِ. One day we're gonna die. Dying does not mean you done. There's gonna be question in the grave. You're going to have another life. Where are you going to stay in the grave for questions? In sharran fa sharru, wa in khayran fa khayru. Good for good and evil for evil. Everybody gotta think about these things. So follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do not be misguided. Try to learn it. It's not about what somebody else is doing in the masjid. Ask yourself, this sheikh, this imam, this brother, what they're doing, is it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? It's not about having like, you have the, you know, people will be like, oh, you talk, you say my sheikh, it's not right. Just look at it, whether it's from kitab or sunnah. Al-haqq yu'rafu bi-adillati tashri'iyya la bi-kathrati fa'ilin. It's not because your parents are doing, or your father or your brother. It is because it is right, because it is from kitab wa sunnah. وَعَلَى فَهْمِ سَلَفِ الْأُمَّةِ. If you know these things, you're good. You're good. You're not going to be fighting for no reason. So brothers, please, learn from the from your teachers. Come to masjid. Don't be arrogant. For your akhirah, learn the Quran, learn the sunnah, ask questions. What I'm doing, is it from the sunnah? Can you, brother, check for me if I'm doing the right thing? Always check to make sure. Otherwise, wallahi al-azim, one day you're going to cry. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. No money, no kids, they're not going to help you except the person who returns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with purity of the heart. He has a soul free from shirk, free from fisk, free from ma'asiyah. Now, that's how he's going to make it. Qalbun Salim. May Allah make it easy for us. Brothers, this is the foundation. Now we're going to build upon it. We're going to talk about sab'ul mubiqat. Seven destructive major sins. And inshallah, I need everybody to pay attention. And it's important when you are at the majal of knowledge, either you have your phone, either you have some book and pen, you're writing the knowledge down. Because you never know. If you don't keep it, you may lose it. But once you understand it, you go back home, you teach your kids. So in the hilaf of knowledge, you have your pen, your pencil, your paper, your phone, that you have the notes, you keep records of what you're benefiting from. Barakallahu feekum. So inshallah ta'ala, we're going to benefit from the book of the noble Imam Al-Allama Ibn Baz rahimahullah ta'ala. Na'am, which is Ad-Durus Al-Muhimma Li'amat Al-Ummah. very beautiful books. From the beautiful books that we have, that I encourage everybody to try to get this book. Now it is in English. Wallahi, try to get it. And get one, a copy in your home, and get copy for your kids. It teaches about aqeedah, shirk, tawheed, about tafsir, fiqh, how to make wudu, how to follow the janazah, and the like, some beautiful hadith on akhlaq, and the like. Wallahi, ya akhi, get this book. If you ask me to give you this book, I'm not gonna give it to you. If you say you're gonna give me a lot of money, I'm not gonna give it to you. Because as I read and benefit, I write some things in it. Now, in order to remind myself, perhaps maybe when the imam asks me, I can give to the imam. Maybe the imam, only imam can. This is like, I say, well, I got it, man. But alhamdulillah, I hope he got it, inshallah. Yeah. So inshallah, sometimes you can go to the market, look for it. The important lessons for the generality of the ummah by Ibn Baz. When you get it in English and the like, come put it in the masjid. You can buy 5, you can buy 6 for people to benefit. And sometimes, now the imam will take it and start explaining to us one after the other. And also I'm gonna mention one of the books inshallah to help us in our topic. Now, the book of Kaba'ir of Imam Al-Dhahabi. Beautiful, you learn all the major sins. And the scholars even mentioned what he has in the book, right? It's not all of it. It's beyond that. Kaba'ir, major destructive sins. That's why the Sha'iri says, "Araktu sharra la sharri." Once you know the evil, you'll be able to what? To stay away from it. If you have a little kid, for instance, that you're telling him, "This is a red sign, man. This is danger." And he will not listen to you. And he goes to go touch the thing. And something what? It's electrifying. He said, "Did I tell you not to go there? You think the next day he's going to go?"
Yeah.
That's why you have to teach your son this is evil. Because if he knows it's evil, he's going to run away from it. Catch them young. You have to start early. Well, your son in America is going to college. That's when you're going to begin to teach him Tawheed. Illa ma rahim Allah. He's in the dunya, man. And he's gonna start talking, man. That man, that is not, you know, he got a limited perspective of life. You teaching your son Tawheed, he's telling you have what? You have small mind. Why? Because he thinks right now he's in college, man. Some of them, they go to college, they don't want to come to what? The dunus. Now, Saturday and Sunday class, khalas, he's done. When the imam meets him, why you don't come for the durus, you don't learn the Quran anymore? I'm in college. A'udhu billah, man. We're seeking knowledge till death, until the grave, man. As I speak to you right now, I'm trying to run away from America to go sit with the people of knowledge to benefit. I'm praying to go. I'm not gonna keep, because I mean, I'm not gonna stay here when I know there are some things I need to cover in knowledge. It's about my akhirah. Na'am, barakallah, because the more you seek knowledge, you benefit and it gets increased. That's how it is, brothers. Wallahi, we love you for Allah. It is for khayr that we're here. So everybody gotta pay attention to these things. Look at our kids today. No tawheed. Meaning they don't study tawheed, they easily act on shirk and some elements of kufr, and they even insult their parents. They think it's alright. They don't know that fighting the parents, disobeying the parents is one of the major sins. So your father is saying, "Ya akhi, my son, stop." He said, "Hey, I'm not gonna stop. Do this for me." I didn't do that. Because he doesn't know how dangerous this thing is. So we gotta teach our kids, man. Otherwise, it's gonna come back to hurt us. Now, look at the mother of Imam Malik. When he was a little kid, she used to send him to what? Rabi'a al-Ra'i. Imam Rabi'a, to teach him akhlaq, to teach him tawheed, to teach him sunnah. When he was a little kid. But look at Imam Malik today. La yuftah wa malikun fil Madinah. They used to say nobody's gonna give fatwa as long as Imam Malik is in Medina. But Imam Malik is following kitab wa sunnah. He used to say that in sahha al-hadithu fa huwa madhhabi. If hadith is authentic, it is my path. So that you don't blind follow him. So that you don't blind follow him. Some people, when they see the hujjah, the dalil, they say, but Imam Malik says to follow dalil, not to follow him. One of the times, right, he was teaching the masjid in Medina, then he mentioned something, and he says, كُلُّ يُؤْخَذُ مِنْهُ كَلِمَتَهُ وَيُرَدْ إِلَّا صَاحِبْ هَذَا الْقَبْرِ فَأَشَارَ إِلَىٰ قَبْرِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمُ. Whoever speaks, you can either take his statement when it's in accordance to the haqq, or reject his statement when it is accordance to batil, except the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he pointed at the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Only Prophet speaks and he becomes final. So, but now, the problem is not the madhab, but at-tamadhub. It's not just the madhab, but when there's dalil, you say, no, I'm gonna blind follow. That's the problem, to be fanatic. Now, so some people, they come to the masjid, you teach them the sunnah, they say, no, Abu Hanifa. Even when the hadith is what? Clear, they say, but Imam Abu Hanifa. Alhamdulillah, in Greenpoint Masjid, Brooklyn Masjid, a lot of brothers used not to understand, but we keep teaching, little by little. We keep teaching, but now, alhamdulillah. Now, themselves, they follow you, they want to learn. So we have to be patient, but we have to keep teaching. Wallah, brother, we don't need your money. When I finish class here, don't come to me and say, you're going to give me money. I don't need your money. For what? I'm not here for you to pay me. I'm here for you to understand the deen. Wallahi, that's the purpose, for you to understand. If you don't know the deen, you give me money, what am I going to do with it? A'udhu billah, yani. So some people, all they care about is that, oh, we're going to help the imam, we're going to do this, but when it's time for durus, you don't see them. You don't see them, they don't come to the masjid. Illa ma rahma rabbi. Because they think we are the leaders. If you're the leaders, that is the time to learn the deen, to stay in the masjid. But a lot of people, you don't see them in the masjid. By anything, you need money, somebody needs money, they help. But they don't know, they don't stay in the deen. This is not good. Aib Allah. So we're praying to Allah to help our brothers learn the deen. Barakallahu fikum. So brothers, this is the path of haqq. You teach your kid tawheed, you teach them to know shirk. And that's the first thing you begin with. When a brother is taking shahada, after taking shahada, you let the imam teach him tawheed, to understand the kalima of tawheed. But some people, they will just take them, you know, doing some things, teaching them some things, not beginning with tawheed. Khabar. Because if he knows the tawheed, the aqeedah, the iman is going to be strong, then he's going to keep the prayers. But if the tawheed is not strong, he may take shahada and leave it the following week. You meet him on the street, brother, why you don't come to the masjid anymore? I thought you took shahada last. I ain't got no money, man. The brother don't want to help me. He thinks when he takes shahada, it's about money. Teach him tawheed, to understand the tawheed, to know that it is about his akhirah, it's not about the imam. Yeah, one brother came to me, I ain't got nothing. And since I took shahada, I said, brother, man, come on, man, sit down here, let me teach you something, man. Do you know tawheed? He said, what tawheed? So it's time for you to learn. Now this is a teaching moment. I started teaching him in Georgia. We started learning. Later on, he came, he said, Imam, man, may Allah reward you, man. He said, Aki. I said, yes. You know, when they feel good, they say, Aki. Then I said, no, I ain't worry about Aki now. Later on, I'll teach him to say, Aki. But because he loves me, he said, Aki, man, may Allah reward you, Aki. Then I said, may Allah reward you, my brother. It's all about Tawheed, man. Imagine this brother, nobody teaches him Tawheed. He came with this angry face. You teach him, he's a teaching moment. Because if you teach him Tawheed, wallah, he knows Tawheed, he knows who Allah is. He's going to be fair, inshallah ta'ala. One of the mashayikh was asked, why some brothers going to kill themselves? He said, because they don't know tawheed. They commit suicide because they don't know tawheed. How somebody going to make sujood to Allah? And now he is in trouble. He cannot think about anything but to kill himself. In Long Island, was it 12 years ago, if you had somebody kill himself, and he wrote even a will, all his money, everything, leaving it for cat. Because what? He's tired of life. Do you think if these people know tawheed, they'll kill themselves? That way, they commit suicide? Because as if you're saying that Allah cannot do for you. Now, ya sahib al-hammi, inna al-hamma mufarijun, أبشر بخير فإن الفارج الله. اليأس يقطع أحيانا بصاحبه، لا تيأسا فإن الصانع الله. وإذا بليت فثق بالله وارض به، إن الذي يكشف البلوى هو الله. والله والله ما لك غير الله من أحد، فحسبك الله في كل لك الله. Come on man, everything you got Allah. If you know the Tawheed, you're gonna commit shirk. If you know the Sunnah, you're gonna do bid'ah. If you know the Quran, you're gonna listen to music. If you have strong aqidah, you want to kill yourself. وَلِكُلِّ أَجَلٍ كِتَابٍ. You wait, it's gonna be time for death. D-E-A-T-H, mean what? Mount. Everybody has an appointed time for death. But if you try to rush, عَبْدِي بَادَرَنِي بِنَفْسِهِ. If you try to kill yourself, then Allah is going to forbid for you entry to Jannah. أعوذ بالله ومن زحزح عن النار وأدخل الجنة فقد فاز وما الحياة الدنيا إلا متاع الغرور. What you going to do with this dunya? So whenever you are in a situation, you are trying قدر الله وما شاء فعل. When somebody is dead in your family, إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. It's also قدر. قدر الله وما شاء فعل. When someone slaps you without thinking about it, قدر الله وما شاء فعل. أو قدر الله وما شاء فعل. This how you do. Something happens to you in your life, or you never expected to meet your brother in the market and you see him. So man, this is a coincidence, man, brother. There's no coincidence here, man. It's the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some people, they tell you good luck, bad luck. What you mean by good luck, bad luck, if you know aqidah, if you know tawheed? Whatever happens in your life is from the qadr. Naam. Ilmun kitabatu maulana mashi'atuhu wa khalquhu wa ijabun wa takween. You have to learn these four principles regarding qadr. Inshallah, one day we're going to talk about qadr, inshallah. We need to learn all these things. Otherwise, we're going to be making mistakes in our statement, in our action. Barakallahu feekum. So brothers, learn the seven major destructive sins. When you learn them, inshallah, you're going to be good. In the month of Ramadan, we did a lot of khayr. Now, charity, mashallah, tahajjud, qiyam. And some of the brothers, they already prayed what? They already fasted the 6 days, right? Man sama Ramadan. ثم أتبعه بست من شوال كان كصيام الدهر. Right? أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. You fasted Ramadan, Alhamdulillah. And you follow it up with fasting 6 days of Shawwal. It's as if you fasted for a whole year. The rewards for entire year that a person fast in them, you in 6 days, Allah gonna write all this reward for you. SubhanAllah. Now you did some good. You helped the brothers. You brought some food in the mosque. You brought some water. Alhamdulillah. But these are good things. How about the evil ones? You need to also learn them. So you know the good, you know what? The bad to avoid. So may Allah have mercy on the soul of Ibn Baz, rahimahullah. He says, At-tahdhir min ash-shirk وأنواع المعاصي. Warning against the shirk and the rest of the kinds of dhunub. Na'am. All the kinds of what? Sinning against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I'm gonna mention the seven destructive middle sins so we know that we prepare our mind. The seven. If you know them now, it's easy to teach your kids to memorize for them to understand. Na'am. So the first one is الشرك بالله. The first one is what? الشرك بالله. The greatest of these sins, the seven sins, is shirk بالله, associating others with Allah, which leads to doom with no hope of redemption. And if a person dies in this state, he will abide in hellfire forever. SubhanAllah, if a person dies committing shirk, is gonna be in hellfire forever. That's why if you see somebody going to marry, or somebody playing with the jinns, or somebody saying he's gonna help you to make money, and you're scared to be poor, SubhanAllah, man, where's your tawheed? وَكَيْفَ تَخْشَى الْفَقْرُ وَاللَّهُ وَلَا زِيْكُمْ. When you know Allah is Ar-Razzaq, why are you going to get scared of poverty? So some people, because of this fitna, they go to Maram. They go to fortune tellers and the like. Look, in America, when they mention something like computer magic, sometimes they just mean computer one, magic skills to make money and to increase their knowledge. But in Africa, when you mention computer magic, they're doing sihr, witchcraft. Somebody using computer to make money, you're using computer for shirk, to destroy yourself. Even though sometimes when they say computer magic, it involves kufr, because they have computer magic pranks and they have computer magic tricks. That one you want to see kufr and shirk in it. But sometimes when they mention computer magic, they're talking about how good you are in computer, the skills. But you want to see some one of the brothers, I was asking him, where's your son? He goes, we used to talk to his son would not listen. So we stopped seeing in the masjid. And I asked him, where's your son? He said, Imam, inshallah, khair, khair. I didn't know what's going on. He don't want to talk about his son. Now one of his brothers called me and said, Imam, you asking about his son? He's in jail now. What happened? He's using computer to defraud people, to make him money. Now they got him, he's in jail. I would have been that. When I call and say, brother, man, we've been telling you this place, man. Teach your son Tawheed, teach him. You are in a place in which they don't really know Islam, man. People are trying to manage their deen and understand. And you quiet, you don't want to teach your kids. Now they're following the path of the kufr and the shirk. Look at what he's doing right now. Trying to rob the bank. Use some numbers to cheat on people, to steal. They're doing all this, what do they call them? Scamming, right? He's in the jail, man. He's caught doing all these things, using the computer to do some magic and the like, to get some money. Now they got him, man. He's gonna serve a lot of years, man. When I was mentioning this, and the brother was crying, man. He said, Mom, you said this, man. That's my son, man. I love him, but I don't know, man. I should have taught him, man. I said, brother, keep making dua, but you destroy his life, man. He said, Imam, I know it's not him, man, it's me, man. He started mentioning a lot of things, and I said, you see, when we teach the sunnah, you guys are insulting us. When we teach the sunnah, you say we are mutashaddidun. Is it not better for you to have somebody who can really be straightforward with you to save yourself from hellfire than somebody that makes jokes, that plays around, push your kids into evil? If your son knows Tawheed, he's gonna respect the right of the neighborhood. Even the kuffar is not gonna want. He's not gonna take from their haq. He's gonna respect their rights. He's gonna have good manners. He's not gonna be a part of the irhadiyin. Those who don't have usul, they don't have knowledge, they don't have no imam among them. And they have su'ul fahm, and they have jahl. You're not gonna find no alim among them. And your son is going to say he's going to be with them to destroy places, bringing bad names to Islam. But Islam is what? Free from all these actions. But if your son is learning knowledge, that's how a lot of people are going to understand Tawheed. And they're going to accept the Sunnah. And one day they're going to go learn, steady, to come back to your own people teaching them. Like, oh, we playing, man. We don't know shirk, man. We don't know Tawheed. We need to know Tawheed to be firm. We need to know shirk to stay away from it. Who is going to destroy our actions. وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Subhanallah, the Prophet will never do shirk. But look how Allah speaks here. To tell you that if you commit shirk, you, as you're listening to me right now, all your actions will be destroyed. Because the shirk, if you know Tawheed, you're going to avoid the shirk. Tawheed awwalan. Because if you don't know Tawheed, there's no benefit in what you're doing, of sadaqah, charity, whatever it is. That's why I started with Tawheed. La yahbatanna amaluk. You see the lam of qasr, and also the word, the harf, the noon of tawkeed. To tell you it's not easy, it's serious. One of the sisters, she called me. When she called, she says, brother, you know, I had your khutbah, man. But, you know, my husband, man, he did something in the bathroom, man. I said, sister, man, you gotta talk, man. What's going on? Man, he put some things in the bathroom. He said to protect the house. I don't know what is that. I don't even like it. And I said, give me your address. I'm gonna come into your house now. What is the brother's, you know, when is he gonna come to the house? What is he off? She mentioned. I went to the house and saw the brother. He said, brother, man, you're doing shit in this house, man. He said, what you talking about, Imam? Your wife said there's something in the bathroom, man. He was like, looking at her, looking at me. I said, brother, save yourself. He said, inshallah, Imam. But one brother told me, if I put some things here, we're going to get more barakah in the house. There's going to be khair in the house. I said, ya, akhi, you forgot about Allah? You forgot about Allah? After all the concrete, the cement, the wood, the iron rods that Allah helped you to put together to build the house, you think this small thing, the jinn that you mix in and things that you call in can save you? I said, is it? Take it away and throw it somewhere. Wallahi la wuta. If you were to die when this thing is in this house, ma aflakta abada, you will never be saved. Inna Allah la yaghfiru an yushraka bih. The brother was just looking at me. And I said, yeah, I'm not here for you to pay me nothing. I don't need nothing. Don't even give me water. Don't give me food. I want to help you as my brother for Allah. Finally, the sister called later on. She says, Imam, it's hard for me to take out. I don't know what he talked to those people, but they still calling him. I don't know what's going on, Imam. And she started asking if she can even leave the marriage. Anyway, long story. But now, as I speak to you right now, the marriage is not there anymore. I would have been there. But shame, because of shame, somebody gonna lose his wife and his kids? Because they don't stay with that deal. When you talk to them, they say, oh, my sheikh back in Africa, he told me to hold on to this. So he's gonna be calling the names of the jinns. Zubu Zubu Yahini, Sa'aba Dila, Sa'aba Badila, Aroka Yahini. A'udhu Billah, man! You calling the names of the jinns instead of calling the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qul idu'u Allah, Awidu Rahman. Ayyamman tad'u. Awil Asma'u al-Husna, call the name of Allah. Each time you call the name of Allah, call it with meaning, with sentence, in jumla, and ask Allah what you want. Ya Ar-Razzaq, Ya Razzaq, Uzuqni. Don't say, Ya Razak, Ya Razak, Ya Razak. That's what they are doing. They say, oh, go, you know, if you want to make money so that nobody will catch you when you're trying to get the visa, say, Ya Muntaqim, 1,000 times. You have to do the right thing first. Somebody going to do something wrong and shit, and he say he want dua to be protected. Look, man. He says somebody gave him to be saying, Ya Muntaqim, 1,000 times, he'll be able to get a visa. So he got there, they ask him, what's your name? The guy in this cafe doesn't know he doesn't know your kufur, man. He doesn't know your shit. He's asking you back, you gotta bring your ID document. They say somebody was doing that until they came. The guy called, man, there's Majnun here, come get it. He went back to the sheikh, he asked the sheikh, I said, I'm talking a lot, but he said, that's not what I told you. You have to do what I ask you. Because my people are very jahil. He does not understand the deen. Make the dua from sunnah, do the right thing. Go and pray to Allah about it. Do istikhara. If something is good for you or not, then make dua, be upon the path of sunnah. When you go, they ask you something, don't lie, tell them the truth. Don't change your age. Your beard is white, don't try to paint it black. Well, you gotta be taking shower. It's gonna be what? You gotta go back to the original until you get tired. If you cannot change your soul, what you gonna change your age for? Yeah, things are going on. And how do we know these things? Those people, the very people who do this, they're the one telling us. He said, bro, I saw my brother and they asked him a question, he'd be like, Muntaqim, Muntaqim. I don't understand what you're saying. He doesn't even know the meaning of Al-Muntaqim. He does not know if you ask him. And he doesn't know how to use the names of Allah. When you say Ar-Rahman, Irhamni. Oh Allah, the most merciful, have mercy upon me. You see, you ask for something. Right now, it's somebody is walking.
What's my brother's name?
Muhammad.
Brother Muhammad, and he's walking in front of the masjid. Then you started saying, Muhammad! He turns to look at you and you don't say anything. He said, why are you calling me for? Muhammad! Forget about this one. Because only his name cannot benefit. He wants to know why you call his name. So when you say, Ya Rahman, ask for something. You call in the name of Allah, Ar-Rahman, what you want? Then you say, Ya Allah, your mercy. You see, now it's complete. Muhammad, Muhammad! Muhammad, can you help me open the masjid? Now, it makes sense. This is human level what? Example. How much more of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When you call the name of Allah, you gotta ask something. You don't use the name of Allah for evil. You don't use the name of Allah to say, I'm gonna kill somebody. In shirk way, in kufr way, in the way that the people are doing today. Because why? They forgot about it. It's one of the sabab al-mubiqat, shirk. It takes you away from Islam. Yanqula an al-millah, aw min al-millah. So, but a lot of people are in it. They don't care. And they will come to the masjid making sujood. But he just finished talking to jinns. Just recently, somebody sent me, he said one of the sheikhs in Africa, he says he has about 3 billion jinns. 3 billion jinns.
Yeah.
They entered into one of the Sufi tariqah and all that. Then I say, Sufi, 3 billion jinns entering in, so what? How many people follow Iblis? Shaitan, he got a lot of people. When you go to Africa, man, we deal with shirk. When you come to America, we deal with kufr. Isn't that true? Yeah, it's happening. Now even some of our brothers from Africa, they're teaching the white men how to do shirk. To make quick money. Well, later on something happened. He said, what happened, brother? Well, you know, I gotta speak to my sheikh. You need to teach him tawheed. So it's not about these things people are fighting. You have to correct your tawheed and your aqeedah. Somebody entered the jinn, entered here and that. Somebody will ask you a question, can I marry jinn? Akhi, who told you in the Quran to marry jinn? You have to marry a human being like you. You worry yourself about marrying jinn for this kind of question. Ibn Fawzan, rahimahullah ta'ala, when he was asked, if you know a human being can marry jinn, he said, this is a wedding I never attended, so how can I know? This is a wedding I never attended, man. To tell him, man, what you worry about jinns? Those who worry about jinns, be careful of them. Yeah, be careful. What you worry about jinn for? Yeah, I don't even understand. So you see, if they want to misguide you, they started telling you about jinns. May Allah save all of us. May Allah guide those who are misguided. May Allah make it easy for us. Allah, if you die upon shirk, Allah will not forgive you. That's what he says. Naam, inna Allah la yaghfiru an yushraka bihi wa yaghfiru ma duna dhalika liman yasha. You may see somebody who likes to what? Sometimes steal some things here and there. Later on, perhaps, you know, you go to Ibn Jannah. But a person who commits shirk, you're not going to make it, man. Allah forgive us. So that's number one. The second one is a sihr, witchcraft. It involves shirk because it is worshipping the jinn and is seeking the help of the jinn to misguide the people. The people here. So that's why they say a sihr, they are kuffar. No, بنص الكتاب والسنة وما كفر سليمان ولكن شياطين كفر يعلمون يعلمون الناس السحر. Why did Allah call them kuffar? Because while they're teaching people magic, witchcraft, sihr, they beat the earth to try to do some things, get the name of the people, use the names of the jinns, call the jinns to do some magic for you. If you go there for 40 days, right? You go there for 40 days, you know what's gonna happen? مَنْ أَتَى كَاهِنًا أَوْ عَرَّافًا فَصَدَّقَهُ بِمَا يَقُولُ فَقَدْ كَفَرَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Whoever goes to the fortune teller, or goes to a person that does witchcraft or magic, you have disbelieved in that which Allah has revealed to the Prophet ﷺ. That's Quran. A'udhu billah. Subhanallah, you see how serious it is? Some ruwaya, it says that whoever goes to
A person who does sihr, all these musha'wadheen in the light, لَمْ تُقْبَلْ لَهُ صَلَاةً أَرْبَعِينَ يَوْمًا. For 40 days, your prayer will never be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the ulama, they talk about this. How about, so do I have to keep praying or leave it? You see, now you have to worry about questions. Maybe if he comes to you and say, man, did I ask you to go to this guy, man? You ask him, did I ask you to go to this guy, man? But it's about Sharia, so you have to know the hukum. For 40 days, Allah will not accept your prayers. So are you going to keep praying or are you going to quit until? Do you even know when you're going to die? How about before the 40 days finish, you're dead and gone? Musiba, right? May Allah save us. Wallahi, may Allah save us. It's not, it's one of the major sins in Islam, major crimes in Islam. It's a spiritual criminality. You become spiritual criminal. When you go to tomorrow, nah, 40 days. But the scholars, Ahlulayn, they mention, yes, you're gonna keep praying, but it has no benefit. Amiratul Nasiba. You pray, but Allah will not accept it. So if you pray, you have to keep praying that you not die before the 41, 40 days elapse. May Allah save us from shirk. May Allah save us from shirk. And now we have in Africa, those who go to the Sahara, and even because she loves her husband, she said, how am I going to keep my husband so he will not even get the second wife? So they're going to push her into shirk. So they're going to give her some shirk things mixed with the names of the jinns. They say, whenever you cook for your husband, put it in here. This guy is outside getting tired, trying to make money and take care of you and take care of your kids just because of what? Evil. You're trying to what? Hurt your husband. Especially if the husband happens not to be a person of the dhikr. Now, Shaykh Al-Bani rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions the importance of what? Adhkar of as-sabah wa al-masah. If you say it in the morning, even, it is shifa for you from all this evil. They're trying to get you, they will not. The ibn Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. But when you are weak in your aqidah, in your iman, they take you to all those fitna. It may have an impact on you. By the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as a sister, be the woman of tawheed. Be the woman of tawheed. Whatever happens to you in your life, see Allah. Whatever you get, Allah. When you get angry, Allah. Don't take your husband to no marah. And some men also. He's gonna say this man, my wife, in America, when she gets money, I know I'm in trouble. So he's gonna call his sheikh, but man, my wife, when she look at me sometimes, I get scared. So he want what? He wants sihr, witchcraft to be done. So he's going to destroy the life of this young girl with sihr. He doesn't know that this is sheikh, he takes a person out of Islam. There's some people, they did this sihr on them. You see a brother sick for years. People don't know what's going on. He took him tomorrow. He did shame for him and the money. Wallahi illa wa rahimahullah. So that's why we have to always say the adhkar in the morning and the evening. Because why? You never know who is plotting against you. So then let loose. Always be strong. Fitna illa wa rahimahullah. May Allah make this for us. That is number two. Number three, destructive mental sin is what? Killing a soul whom Allah has forbidden us to kill. This is a serious crime of which Allah says in the Quran. Whoever kills a soul, whoever kills a believer intentionally, he, his recompense is hell to abide therein. And the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are going to be upon him. And a great punishment is prepared for him when you kill a soul. Now, it's more serious to kill a soul than for the Kaaba to be taken away, to be removed. It tells you how serious it is to kill an innocent life. So sometimes when you play, you see the kids playing because you don't have the right teachings. Another kid is telling the other, I'm gonna kill you, man. You think killing is easy? Don't play with it. Because even the Prophet tradition was against this thing. No, you playing, telling your brother, using scaring, using killing, is dangerous. It's one of the major sins to kill. Our kids need to know this thing. So nowadays you see, he say, oh son, I'm gonna go, you know, I'm gonna go to work if you wanna, can I, you know, put on some, you know, healing channels, you know, fighting for you to learn how to. So he's going to see what is happening, they kill one another. Now when he comes back home or go to school, you wanna what? Applying. We gotta be careful, we have to teach our kids that healing is dangerous, one of the major crimes in Islam. And also, number four, consuming riba, eating riba. Usually, today is rampant. We're going to see some massages. They will take the machine for the credit card, they put it in the machine. They say, brother, please swipe. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Hey, you allow people to eat fire in their stomach. When they do their things outside, okay. They want to ask. They're going to be asked by Allah, but now you bring it in the mountain just because you're looking for money. A'udhu billah, you know what they do with those cards? And they say, well, but how about the one, if you pay before the month, so they will not charge your liver. And a little bit, they make one liver, they care. You know, you can get sick. You may not be able to go to work. So the moment you take it, you know what's going to happen. Liver is dangerous. When you talk about Islam, right, you say, can I get a house? One sheikh says, I can do it because I'm in America. This sheikh is going to destroy you, man. Riba is the riba. Na'am. You eat riba? Fa'adhanu bi harbi min Allah wa Rasooli. Allah is telling you, come fight me and my messenger when you eat riba. Tell you how dangerous it is. But people don't care today. He's going to give his brother $1,000. He said, brother, man, I know you don't get it, man. I'm going to give you $1,000. But next month, if you can make it 2,000 for me, man. He's using his brother to make money. No, there's a lot of interest going on. Buying houses and the lot. Man, cut your coat according to your sign. Don't come and ask me, no, no. Instead of paying my bill, $1,000 a month, why can I not get the house so I can be paying $2,000 a month at least? And I said, man, it's better for you to stay with $1,000 than to eat fire in your stomach, man. If you get the money, go buy cash, halal. Why are you going to follow this kind of ways? You'd be surprised, man. Some people are taking cars with a credit card and the line when they cannot give anymore. And then they are jailed. They take the car and they jail you. Faith that there's no barakah in your life. Your risk is no barakah. You're going to get a lot of money. One day you get sick, you're going to use all this money that you got for years to treat yourself. Perhaps you may not be able to even recover. You want to die with this fitna. So you have to know the tricks of the devil. Now, and there's tahrish in it. That's why Ibn Jawzi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he has a book called The Deception of the Devil. Tell this it is. Go get that book. You want to see how the devil will use certain ways to let you fall into the trap. Allah save us. And number five, consuming orphans wealth. Akul mal al-yatim. Mal al-yatim. Those who consume and eat the wealth of the orphans. His father died and he saved some money for him. You have to take care of this young man. You eat the money, you squander everything. You sold his cars, you sold the houses. إن الذين يأكلون أموال اليتامى ظلما إنما يأكلون في بطونهم نارا.
Those who eat and devour the property, the wealth of the orphans out of oppression,
they are eating fire in their stomach.
On the whole Qiyamah, وسيصلون سعيرا. They will be penalized with the penalty of the hellfire. You
gotta be careful, man. If you cannot help, you tell them you care. But wallahi, an orphan's property you eat, Allah say you eat in Jahannam in his stomach. Allah save us. Number six, fleeing from the battlefield.
Nah. Because when there's a religious expedition, we should rule there. And the Wabit and everything, and the Dawla, Muslima, and the light. And you run away, you flee. Now, because why is going to make the Muslims weak? They're going to be killed and destroyed because why you left? So you're going to sleep. But it's not in the hands of any other person. It's in the hands of one. One, this, the decision of Allah, but there has to be hatred of the Muslims. You have to be ulama, the qudha, the ulama Muslim. Don't take the laws into your hands. You won't take the law into your hands. You won't help the people for no reason. It's not what this kilab al-nar, the dogs of the hellfire, khawarij. They're going to be killing people, destroying the people for no reason. Su'ul fahm, the jahl. They don't know the shurut, they don't know the dawabit, they don't know anything about it. No alim will ask them to do this thing. It's dangerous. This is one of the major sins when you find yourself in this thing. And number seven, right? Slandering, chaste, innocent, believing woman. You want to see a young girl just because you hate her, or just because you wanted to marry her, she said no, then you start painting her black. When she's walking, they see this girl, she does the zina, man. And you lie, man. Whether old or young, nah. Whether a woman that has been forced for what? For a rape. Don't accuse her. Don't accuse no woman, man. You call and say, wallah, she's zania. Alhamdulillah. Do you have the witnesses? Before you accuse something of zina, you have to bring how many witnesses? Four. That's what some scholars mentioned. If you have three witnesses, it's not up to four. You get a whip. Nah. It's four you brought for them. They have to whip you. Because it's not easy. Accusation is dangerous. These are seven destructive major sins. May Allah make it easy for us. So brothers, it's almost time for Azan, right? Let's turn it up. So brothers, the sins are more than seven, but these seven, we want to mention them one after the other. What's number one? Ashir. Number two? Asir. Number three? Tatlunas. Number four? Abnal Yatim. Number five? Akl Riba. Number six? Watawali Yawma Zahra. Number seven? Wakafu Muhsanat al-Ghafilat al-Mu'minat. These are the six we have to protect and guard against. I mean seven. Some people came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from among the companions. When they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet mentions that ishtaribu sab'al aniqat, stay away from seven destructive middle sins. Subhanallah. And the scholars, they mention why it is called mubiqat. Why is it called mubiqat? The scholars, they mention because they are destructive. They destroy you and destroy your akhirah. They are dangerous crimes in Islam. So the companions, when the Prophet mentioned this, they ask him, Ya Rasulullah, what are they? Oh, Messenger of Allah, show us. What are they? And this can be found in the book of Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim. Na'am. Ishtaribu sab'al aniqat. قالوا يا رسول الله وما هم لبرنا ماشي الشرك بالله والسحر وقتل النفس التي وقتل النفس التي أمر الله إلا بالحق وأكل الربا وأكل مال اليتيم وتولي يوم الزحف وقتل المحصنات المؤمنات الغافلات ومعنى اجتنبوا أي ابتعدوا stay away from it forever وكونوا في جانب بعيد عن الوقوع فيها move away from falling into it it's gonna destroy you كما قال خليل الرحمن عليه الصلاة والسلام في دعائه واجنبني وبني أن نعمل الأصنام. Oh Allah, save me, protect me, move me away, me and my son, me and my sons, family members,
that we worship the idols. It's shirk. We don't want to pray that, oh Allah, remove us. Look at Luqman. What did he tell his son? Ya bunayya la tushrik billah inna ash-shirka lazulmun adheem. Oh my son, don't. See, ya bunayya. Literally, ya bunayya. La tushrik billah. Sometimes we see when an elder person wants to talk to a child, you hold him by what? By the shoulder. You tell him, ya bunayya. La tushrik billah inna ash-shirka lazulmun adheem. Because what is it? Dangerous oppression, dangerous crime in Islam. Takun dhulman, inna dhulman dhulman yawm al-qiyamah. Run away from what? Oppression. Because it is a serious crime, darkness for the day of judgment. And the serious and dangerous among the shirk. So sometimes the dhulm, when it is used, it is referred to shirk. So we gotta be careful about it. So, the scholars of knowledge, that's why one of the imams, or the scholars of this time, Sheikh Abdul Razak ibn Abdul Muhsin al-Badr, when he was doing the sharh of this book, well, you go to look at this, the sharh, Durus al-Muhimma, the Arab al-Ummah. The one who wrote the book is Ibn Baz, the one who is doing the sharh is what? Sheikh Abdul Razak ibn Abdul Muhsin al-Badr. So he mentioned something very, very important. He said, part of the traditions of the people, right? They try to avoid some food, some things, some food smells, in order to protect the world. Protect their body. They want to keep healthy body, so they don't eat certain things. So how about shirk? They will not try to save themselves from the shirk in order to protect their body into their aqidah, into their deen. Because why? As some food, when you eat them, they can destroy the body. Shirk also will destroy not only your body, it's going to destroy your aqidah. SubhanAllah. If you really serious about what's going to destroy you as far as food and you avoid, how about that is going to destroy your dunya and akhirah? Shirk. So that's why we're going to be careful. And also, as part of what they mentioned, as part of some of the shirk or the way of sins, to tell you is more than that. For the Prophet mentioned, Allah and the people can be equal in kala'i. Shall I not mention to you the most major of sins? قال بلى يا رسول الله او مسجد of Allah, tell us, we want to know. قال الاشراب بالله. Number one, shirk is dangerous. That's the chief, that's the better one. وعقوق الوالدين, and also being disobedient to the parents. When your parents ask you to do something evil, لا وقوق do it. لا طاعة للمخلوق في معصية الخالق. But your parents ask you to do something good, خير, and it's not beyond you, don't talk bad to your family, your parents, your father, your mother. Don't disrespect them. Don't be arrogant in front of your parents. They tell your son, come to you. Hey, to that mommy, what you mean? You look with this face to your dad? Wallah, you committed major sins. Major crime in Islam. Allah hates you. You gotta fear Allah and respect your parents when they talk to you. So thank you, mommy. I thank you for the food you've given me. Son, don't do with these guys, man. They smoking weed, man. Mommy, I want to be there. Yeah, when you go there, it's going to affect you, man. Stay away from those who smoke weed, man. Otherwise, even you cannot walk on your feet properly. Sometimes you speak to them, look at how they talk. What you say, man? The mind is what? Destroyed with weed. He cannot talk properly. Someone else in Georgia, one of the guys came to me. So I don't want to do with Imam. And I said, tell me what you looking for, what you want to do? Imam? Imam? And I said, he keeps calling my name. I said, what's going on, man? Then later I found out that man, he smoked weed, man. He's confused. And the family member said, man, please help us in Dua. And I said, but what did you do? What were you teaching? Did you help him to go to the mountain? Imam, but that's why I brought him here to you. You see, when the thing is worse, they bring it to the Imam. When the Imam said, come back, they're going to go to some party. You know, he's going to go sleep over. What's she call it? Sleep over. You know, when they go to other friends to sleep in some people's house, sleep over. You tell him, come back, Quran, man. The guy is saying, sleep over. Now, the guy is full of weed. They say, I ain't got no solution, let me go to the masjid. Imam ain't got no cure, man.
But so we have to listen now before it becomes what worse. May Allah be pleased. So respect your parents, Allah is going to reward you. If you disrespect your parents, know that you have committed major sins. Your life is not going to be good. You're going to end up like those guys end up. Or shahad to sue and also false witness. Those who give false witness. Because it's coming from lying. A person that accuses others is a liar. Because why? Because of your lie, you're going to destroy somebody's honor. Somebody is going to lose his job because of your lie. Those who respect the brother will not respect you because you lie. You hide and lie against either one of the brothers in the market. You accuse them. And you swear to Allah. This is a major crime. Allah is not going to ask. When you die, you will test hell. There are some people, they go to the Facebook, they write, you know, that guy, man, he's lying. You got to be careful the way you face, you face the book, man. You may face hell. Is that true? Don't go there and be lying. And it may be used against you. It's not good. So it's a lot of them. Inshallah, we're going to stop here. We ask Allah to forgive us. If we said something right, may Allah bless you in the scale of hasanat that went there. If we made a mistake, we ask Allah to forgive us. If there's any question, just can ask. And don't worry, if I say anything, there's no dalil. Tell me and where's the dalil, man. And I'm a correct if I don't have no dalil. Wallah, the deen is not for me. Yep. If I say something you feel like it's not right, correct me if I'm with dalil. If you say, man, you're wrong, man, then I ask you, what's your dalil? Well, I don't have no dalil. Yep, because al-hujjah la tuharam illa bil-hujjah. That's how it is. يا الله الله وربك حمدك الله وبحمدك وشهد الله لا إله إلا الله صلى الله على نبينا الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين نعم بارك الله فيكم إذا لم يكن جواب